man Wilpa will call. And even if night, I hurry to my blue heaven. You turn to the right, you find a little bright light that leads you to my blue heaven.
G'day guys, welcome to another episode of My Blue Heaven. It's Friday. If I'm pumping out these videos at the moment, it means in football parlance is I am in a heavy training load. I've been put through my paces by Andrew Russell. And yeah, got plenty of momentum at the moment, so I'll try and keep pumping them out for you guys. Let's see how that pans out for the rest of the season. Just quickly, I know it's 24 hours out before a really important game against Essendon. I've already spoken about that in Wednesday's preview. But just at that stage, we didn't realise that, one, Mackay was under an injury cloud and it eventuated that he's not playing. And two, we didn't realise, obviously, Sam Philp was going to make his debut for the Carlton Football Club, which is fantastic for him. So congratulations to the youngster. It's well-deserved. It's very exciting for him. It's very exciting for us as supporters to see another talented youngster come through. And I think the thing about Sam Philp, similar to Sam Walsh last year, that he's doing all the right things. You know, and what we hear is his attitude, the way he applies himself has been first class. You know, and it was a bit of a, I suppose, it was a bit of a pick that he wasn't, I suppose, predicted to go that early in the draft. Sometimes you get a little bit sceptical when you sort of just pluck a player from the draft who was maybe expected to go a little bit later. But, you know, the things he's shown in the practice matches in the JLT, in the practice match against Collingwood, we're seeing a kid who loves to hunt the footy, loves to hunt the man, has got tremendous intensity. And a lot of pace and is a particularly good kick as well. So I think in time we're going to see a very good footballer. Let's not put too much pressure on him though tomorrow. It's a big occasion, big stage, although there's not going to be, you know, 80,000, 90,000 people there, but still national audience. It's going to be tough. You know, it's going to be tough for the kid, but I'm sure he'll apply himself really well. And let's just hope he can contribute to a very good win for us tomorrow, which is really important. Just quickly on Harry, disappointing that he's not getting that continuity, which we want from him and our big key forwards or any of our youngsters. We need multiple games in the likes of Harry. We're not seeing it with Charlie Curnow. And it's disappointing that we haven't been able to get those guys together for a long period of time. So let's just hope it's only a small injury concern and just soreness. And hopefully we'll see him back next week. Today's episode, like last week's Friday episode, is a player focus. I want to go through the list. I suppose have a look at some of our youngsters or in that age bracket who mightn't be living up to expectations or might be going through a bit of a form slump. And I spoke about Will Setterfield last week, and I thought it was a small step forward for Setterfield. He's still got a long way to go, but I spoke about his background and the context of where he's come from and maybe get back to the basics. And we saw that. We saw that on the weekend. He led the game in tackles. He was in more centre clearances around stoppages. He got to man up on the likes of Joel Selwood and Dangerfield at times. So although it was a small step forward for Will Setterfield, today's player focus is another player that appears to be struggling, and for me, one of the most intriguing players on our list. And I'm not quite sure if this is the right word, but he's almost become a little bit of an enigma. The fact that we haven't seen a lot of him, I suppose, over the preseason, we don't hear a lot about him in terms of the way he's going. And we don't hear a lot of him in regards to media. He doesn't speak a lot. And that is Matthew Kennedy, who's now, third year at the Carlton Football Club. And look, let's be frank, I think so far what he's offered has been, I wouldn't say, yeah, it's been disappointing, but probably the better word is underwhelming, considering the expectations and what we probably hope for from Matthew Kennedy when he first arrived at the club. So when he first arrived, if we would have said then, what we expect from Matthew Kennedy in 3 years' time or 2.5 years' time, I think most of us would have said that Matthew Kennedy would be part of our midfield rotation and be an integral part and a staple of our midfield rotation by now. The fact that he's out of our best 22 and he's fit, there are slight concerns with that. And out of contract as well, it almost needs to get a wriggle on. So what's happening behind the scenes with Matthew Kennedy? I mean, who knows? I mean, we're not inside the football club. We're not privy to inside information. And me personally, I don't know Matthew Kennedy, but I'm here to maybe dig a little bit deeper. And try and get a bit of a read on where Kennedy's at, because I don't think it's a case of just, okay, his papers have been stamped and he's out of contract. You know, he'll play a few games this year and then that'll be the end of him. We sort of give him the flick and we never see him again. I don't think it's as simple as that. I think every player on our list deserves opportunity if their form warrants it. And what we do know about David Teague is it's more than just form, though. It's application and having a really good attitude. So I've actually formed a, and I noticed that Kennedy's actually an emergency for tomorrow's game, which is for me a real positive. Means he's knocking on the door and he may be not that far away. I've actually formed a bit of a hunch or a theory on Matthew Kennedy. So bear with me. And when you formulate theories, you got to be a little bit careful because, as I said before, I don't know the guy. I'm only basing this on what I've read, doing a little bit of research on his background like I did with Setterfield, and maybe having a look at his pathway into football and then his pathway to Carlton and to where he's at now. So what do we know? He's just turned 23, which is a real sweet spot as far as I'm concerned, and we don't have a lot of those players in that age bracket. You know, we're talking that age bracket of 24 to 28. He's not quite there yet, but he's going to, if he's able to get his act together, he's going to formulate that real nice bit of experience that we need in that age bracket. Played the 41 games, kicked the 21 goals. 19 of those games came in his first two seasons at the GWS, which is a pretty good effort considering, you know, the amount of midfield talent they had then with Matthew Kennedy. And then 22 games in two seasons with us in a bit and hasn't played so far this year. Originally picked number 13 from the Giants back in 2015, which, again, you sort of get the feeling he's been around a little bit longer than that. But when you sort of stack it up, he was in the same draft as Weeders, Harry, Charlie, David Cunningham, and also Jack Silvani. So you look at those guys and think they're still relatively young. And so Kennedy's still relatively young. So he still has that on his side, but whether he has the time on his side is another question. When he left the Giants after 2 years, we gave up a pick in the 20s for him. That was interesting in itself. He was an academy player for the Giants, and I'll talk about that a little bit later on. So they bidded for him. Actually, Richmond bidded for him at pick 13, and the Giants matched it. So I actually thought, what would it been like if the Giants didn't match that bid, and he ended up at Richmond in 2000? You know, his first year would have been 2016. He would have gone right through that really successful period of the Tigers. Would we have seen a completely different player in regards to Richmond's culture and what they were building at that time? And I think that's really, really interesting in itself. Because I think part of the problem with Kennedy is based on where he's been or where he went to first and where he came to, which is us. So that's a little bit of his background. So my theory with Matthew Kennedy is based on, I think he had it fairly easy as a junior. And why I say that is I think he was a bit of a man child. And you look at his nickname, Bam Bam, and it suggests to me that he was a big boy, okay? So compared to maybe the other kids he played for when he played for the Rams in the TAC competition. He's a solid type kid who did it pretty easy and maybe wasn't challenged as much as someone who is maybe lighter in frame and maybe someone else who had maybe less talent. And I don't think he probably ever pushed himself. And the fact that the Giants, he said in an interview before he was drafted that the Giants always guaranteed that they were always going to match a bid. So he always knew where he was going. He always knew he was going to be drafted. So it was more a case for me with Matthew Kennedy, it was more, and this is a hunch or a theory, that you need me, okay? You need me rather than I need you mentality of going into the system, which is interesting. And when he finishes at the Giants, okay, he then, after 2 years in the system, which, you know, he'd shown a little bit of ability, but it wasn't like he was an outstanding, you know, his first 2 years in the system were absolutely outstanding. You know, he was serviceable with the Giants, but then there was a lot of hype about him coming to us. Okay, it was almost like Soss went to him and said, we really need you, okay, to come to us, which is okay. But it's more about, okay, they want me. You know, I'm only 20 years of age and they're virtually guaranteeing me a game straight to the midfield to be Patrick Cripps' ally as an inside midfielder. Rather than what have I got to offer? It was almost like a lot of it was handed to him on a platter. And that's he wouldn't be the only one who'd been in that situation. There'd been plenty of youngsters coming through the system where they've had it pretty easily because they dominated at the lower level. And I think the reason why Kennedy, because he was highly rated as a junior, he dominated at the level because he's a good player, but he was physically bigger, physically stronger, okay? And that Bam Bam nickname suggests to me that it's almost like there's a bit of a bullying mentality to it as well. So I think the reason why he hasn't quite come on is not so much about talent. I think the talent is there. And I think we have seen little snippets of his talent. But I think it's more about application and work rate and dedication rather than about the talent. And I think hopefully the penny has dropped for him now that to make it in this caper, you need more than just talent. And I think when he first went to the Giants, he went into a club which was really still starting to find their way. And I'm not going to be critical of the GWS leadership group and the leaders of the football club. I'm sure it was trying to build a really professional environment. But he goes into a new franchise and there's not a huge culture there where the expectations aren't that high. So a kid goes into this culture and it's almost like he's just gifted a couple, you know, games in his first two seasons. Where if he's gone to a Hawthorn or a Geelong, he would have really need to work his way, okay, work his way and maybe had a lot more leadership under him to actually show him what it is to become a really good AFL footballer. And that's all about application. And then he arrives under exactly the same circumstances to us. Now let's have a look. 2017, he arrives to us. Murph's still skipper. We're going through a real transition. A lot of young players on the list. Questionable leadership, no disrespect to Murph. Blokes trying to find their way. He comes in as a 20-year-old and going, we need you, bang, okay, you're fantastic, in you come. Once again, he doesn't have that culture, okay, within the Carlton Football Club about this is what you need to do, okay, to be a worthwhile part of the team. And he just comes in and he thinks it's all going to happen. And unfortunately for Matthew Kennedy, and I know he's had a few injuries, it just hasn't happened. And I think it's all about work rate. One thing that I did notice, and also he played, this is what another thing, why he was physically bigger. As a junior, so I'm talking 16, 17 years of age, he played in a senior premiership with Colin Gully, or Gully, I think it may be pronounced. Apologies to anyone from that area. It's in the Riverina, New South Wales Riverina. He's three older brothers and kicked three goals in a senior grand final. That suggests to me, one, he's a very good player, but two, fuck, he's got the physical capabilities, okay, to dominate, okay? Dominate against, you know, hack country footballers, but then to actually dominate against skinny raw kids in the TAC competition. He knew he could do it. He knew, okay, he had those physical capabilities. So that was another thing there. So my problem with Kennedy is he comes into two clubs which probably lack culture and definitely lack leadership and guidance. Because I think some players just naturally had that. And it's all about socialisation. Now, I reckon, okay, that Matthew Kennedy, because of the nickname Bam Bam and because he's a country kid in a small town, it's more like a big fish in a small sea. Now, I wouldn't be surprised that because he was so good and he dominated, he probably had smoke blown up his ass. And there's nothing wrong with that. So you get this sort of warped sense of what reality is. And I think it's now hitting like a bit of a brick wall that it's a lot fucking harder at AFL level than just being a kid with talent and a kid with a bit of physical size. What I was surprised about, that he actually has got really good endurance, ran a 14.2 beep test at the draft combine in his draft year. I didn't realise that, but that suggests to me it's not so much about how far you can run in a beep test, but how far you want to push yourself in a game situation. So I never think that we should just put a line through a player. And I know there's quite a few of you out there who would say that he's had his chances. And where does he fit in to our structure? Where does he fit into the team? What I've been impressed about and what the reports you hear about Matthew Kennedy this year is a definite change in attitude and application. I really like the report, and I said in the last episode, you got to take some of these reports, these scratch match reports, with a grain of salt. They're all very, very positive. But this one about Kennedy, I really liked. Leadership on the ground, an appetite, hungry, and really wanted to be involved and really wanted to guide the youngsters. Maybe the penny has dropped for him. Maybe he realised that he's facing football mortality in his face. He's out of contract. Maybe he realises that he needs to fucking work hard to get into this team now. Maybe he realises, he looks at the likes of Michael Gibbons, a rookie, who just comes in and applies himself and works hard and is getting a game. Maybe he looks at Jack Nunes and thinks, I'm fucking better than you blokes. Maybe he looked at those guys last year and go, Why aren't I getting a game? I've actually got more talent than these guys. But now it's suddenly dawned on him now that, fuck, it's okay to think that. It's okay to think that I think I'm better than you. But there is a reason why I'm not getting a game, and that is because of my attitude. And the reason why I'm not getting a game is because I'm not willing to fucking work hard enough. It's never too late. It's never too late. Liam Jones and Levi Casbolt are perfect examples of that. Okay? We thought they were on the scrap heap. We thought they were gone. Okay? We thought they were gone. I like his strengths. I really do. Contested ball, good overhead. And now I know he's actually got a pretty good tank. So then it becomes about work rate and attitude and mental application. I like those strengths. So where does he fit in? Where do I think he fits in? I like his versatility, and I think he's knocking on the door because there are a number of players in the team who I think he could take their spot. And it's going to become about opportunities for Matthew Kennedy, and opportunity's going to come. It's going to come if he's got a really good attitude. He just has to bide his time, okay? Whether it's poor form or injuries, that opportunity will come. There's no doubt about that. So it's just about when. I think he's vying for a similar position to a Jack Silvani, which at this stage is a high half forward. But in time, if he's able to get his act together, I think he'd become a pretty serviceable and a really worthwhile part of our midfield rotation, which was the reason why we got into the football club in the first place. He's a reasonably good kick on either side of the body, and he has shown that he can go forward and kick a goal, and he's strong overhead. Does he use his physical capabilities enough as he crashing packs and tackling with intent? Maybe not, but that could also be about application as well. I'm not going to make any predictions about where Matthew Kennedy is going to end up because he's got a fucking lot of work ahead of him. But I'm actually confident that when he does get an opportunity, we might see a different Matthew Kennedy. Okay, one that really wants to be out there. I'm not saying he didn't want to be out there, but is out there for the right reasons because he wants to be part of a team and he wants to be an AFL footballer because you know you have to work hard and you have to be professional. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm completely reading Matthew Kennedy, but I'm pretty confident that I'm not. I'd love to know what you think. Do you think his papers have been stamped? Do you think he's too slow? It's definitely a concern about his speed, but when you get the ball, speed is irrelevant. And the only time I see speed concern with him is when he's plotting in transition, and that's about work rate and that's about application. So I think those areas, let's concentrate on his strengths. I think he's actually probably a more worthwhile midfielder than some of the others we've got in there at the moment. And if he's vying for some of those positions from those blokes that he thinks he's better at, okay, I think that's a really good sign as well. I don't think we've heard the last of Matthew Kennedy. I really don't. I don't know him personally. Country lad, fairly laid back. But, yeah, let's just hope when the opportunity arises that we see a better player and the player that we thought we were going to get. Love to hear your comments below, guys. I will see you either tomorrow night or Sunday morning for the review of the Essendon and Carlton game. For now, it's goodbye from my blue heaven.